Hello and welcome. Boy, it's been a while since I streamed the last time. I think it's probably 2 years ago or a little bit longer, which means this is going to be interesting because everything is like, it's a long time since I did this. So yeah, it's feels very new to me. Like I have a ton of different windows in front of me and I don't know what, like I try to remember what everything is doing. Anyway, thank you so much for joining me today. So what I'm gonna do today is I'm gonna break down the song production for my song Ghostlight in the future. I think about doing this generally in the future, so whenever I release a new song, I do a song breakdown. Song breakdown means I just simply describe how I came up with the song and what was the creative process, but also then open the project and show everything, how it's done, like how I did the sounds, how I did the mixing, how I did the mastering, and all those kind of things. So first of all, let me follow the check and... Okay, so after this stream, we're gonna do some questions. So I'm not gonna go through all the questions right now. Let me start. So the song, for those who don't know, the song has been released last Friday on all platforms. On Spotify alone, in the first week, it made over 400,000 plays. So if you don't know who I am, so you know, okay, the song I released, it's making some plays, so it's not like some random stuff. I also want to talk about the reason why I'm actually doing this song breakdown, because I really enjoy music production streams from other streamers. They're very, very inspiring. I learned so much. So also shout out to Ian Kirkpatrick, Disclosure, and also Ryan from AJR. Also for the people who do those, like who edit the music production streams, because I usually don't have time to watch them for a couple of hours. So for example, Soul State and music production streams, they're streaming, they're like capturing the streams and they're editing them and breaking down the most important parts and putting them on YouTube. That's where I usually watch them. But sometimes I also like to watch them here on Twitch. So this is me just, you know, adding my little part to the community. So, and what's really important for me, before I start is, in music, there's no right or wrong, right? Which means, don't take the stuff that I show you and like, okay, this is how it's done, right? This is one way of doing it. I'm just going to show you a lot of tools creatively, but also like from a technical perspective, like my workflow and everything. But that doesn't mean that this is how it's the correct way to do it. So please don't take it and like go to other people like, hey, this is how it's done correctly. It's not correct. It's just one way of doing it. And the purpose is to give you some more ideas how you could produce music if you're into it, or you just learn something about music production in general. Cool. Just checking the chat real quick. We're gonna do song feedback next week. We just said the question. Let me start with the actual song. Let me click something here so I knew. All right. So the first thing that you obviously need is an idea. And I think what's maybe sometimes underestimated is how many ideas you need to come up with a good idea. That's the question, because often people ask me, hey, how do you come up with a good idea? The thing is, just come up with tons and tons of ideas. So one way to capture idea is with voice notes. So simply on your mobile phone, or on my mobile phone, whenever I have a melody idea, I just put it down in the voice notes. And on January 1st, seriously, I had this voice note right here.
1, 2, 1, 2, 3, 4.
All Okay, I'm just checking. Is the stream laggy again? Let me know if it's not. Let me know if it's not. I have to wait a few seconds to for you to reply, because on my screen was just lagging a little bit, but apparently. All right, cool. Awesome, cool. That's the most important thing. A bit. Okay, yeah, but as long as it's only the video, it's totally fine. Awesome, cool. Thanks for letting me know. Yeah, so this is one of the many melodies. So then one thing that I do is I just get into the studio and I do like new ideas every day, right? So I just sit down, usually for like 2 to 4 hours in the morning. Often I start at 7 a.m. and I make a new idea. And I'm just going to go through a couple of ideas that I had in January around the time. So starting, I think, January 3rd. That's when I got back into the studio, started working on new songs. And so those are very rough ideas. So I have to warn you, there's a lot of like really crappy stuff in there. Yeah, it's for educational purposes. So you see like all the weird stuff that I go through until I come up with an idea that might eventually work. Okay, so let's get started. Number one. This is one, then we have the next one. And the next one. Completely different. And so on and so forth. Next one. And so on and so forth. So it goes like. So. What are you listening to at the moment? Those are just ideas that I do. Like this one, for example, was from January 3rd, also that you just heard. So it's just what I'm showing at the moment is I'm just producing idea after idea after idea until I have something that really sticks with me. So this is you hear the first time I used like this raspy saxophone sound. Pretty shitty melody. Not that impressive, yeah, what I do quite a few times is that I draw ideas from those ideas, right? So I produce new tracks every day, and then something might stick, right? So what else do we have? So this is another idea. And the next one.
Everybody's watching you. Everybody's watching you. Everybody's watching you. Everybody's watching you. Everybody's.
Completely different stuff. And really, like, what is this? Okay, never mind. So. Once again, playing around with the saxophone, that kind of stuck with me. So. And so on. So another one. I don't know what this is. So once again, if you joined, I'm just playing all the ideas that I produced until I finally come up with a. So this is another idea. I think the drum loop is actually just a splice drum loop. So I'm just showing how many ideas for me it needs until I come up with one that I really like. So we're almost there, no worries. Not quite there. And one more. Oh, and this is a little bit interesting. I had a conversation with my wife, and she said, hey, maybe you could want to try some, like, low male voice ideas. Like, use a very low male voice. So, this is... Okay, so also not that great. Then on January 18th, now, so as you can hear, that's the reason once again why I'm playing this to you. I'm just trying weird and a lot of crazy ideas, right? Because to come up with a good idea, you need to just play around, just go crazy. So on January 18th, I remember this voice note. Once again. So I thought, okay, I might try this with this low vocal sound. Okay, so, and this came out of it. Okay, so obviously, it didn't quite work. Next day I did something completely different. Be warned, this is me singing, just like putting down vocal melodies. Okay, never mind. And then the next day I once again came back to this melody here. Said, hey, okay, I had this use the saxophone here. Where was the saxophone? And I could use this melody here with the saxophone sound. So, and then I produced this one here. So this was just one other idea that I produced, like all the ones that I just showed you. I'm not going to go through them again, no worries. So this was January 20th, and that was when I thought, okay, this one? Thought, okay, this one I really like. Okay, so this is the... this is the like creative technique that I'm using. Is I just produce lots and lots and lots of ideas until I have an idea that I really like. And I don't know about how you feel about it. Of course, it might be very different individually, but for me, this one is really different than all the other stuff that I played to you before. It's more there, right? So. Next step, of course, going through the creative process further, it was to arrange it. And yeah, so I wrote verses and put a structure to it. And then I recorded it all myself just to get an idea of it, how it sounds. So be warned, this is the first version, the first full version of Ghostlight with me singing. Okay, I'm gonna spare you the rest, no worries. So, you might probably notice, wait, this sounds like completely different. Yeah, I'm gonna get to that later. Like it's a different song, right? It's there are some elements that are familiar, but it's a different verse and everything. Because the verse changed later. But this, if you're wondering who's singing, yeah, that's me singing. So I recorded the vocals myself and pitched them up. So I recorded them a little lower, and I recorded the entire song. So this is, it was quite some work. Oh yeah, and this was, let me play it a little bit more. No, actually, let me play you the next version. It's a little more easy on the ear, okay? So then I thought, okay, I had the song written. I thought, okay, this might be a good idea. Actually, I already thought of Everglow. And they were like on top of my list of artists that I wanted to work with for this song. But I thought I cannot send them this, right? With me singing with a pitched up voice, that doesn't work. So I don't have any singers around here, but I asked a couple of friends here, some living in Cyprus now. And they recommended me a singer. She's around here. She's doing like, there are a lot of weddings happening in Cyprus. So she's singing on a lot of those weddings. Her name is Celia. And she came to the studio and we recorded the first demo that I then sent to Everglow. And this sounds like that. I'm going to play a little bit more of it so you hear how the song was sounded before. Okay, so from here on, I see that the stream is sometimes getting a little slow. Let me know if the audio drops out. Other than that, you don't need to see my face all the time. as you can hear, so from this point on, where I just played it, the song's pretty much the same. But as you can hear, the verses are very different. So this is the version that I sent to Everglow. And then what was really important for me, this is the next step if you want to make music. I didn't listen to the song, so I finished this demo, I sent it out to them, and then my contact in Asia was taken care of, and my management, and they tried to make it all happen, and it worked out, but this took like 6 weeks. So within those 6 weeks, I never ever listened to the song. That was really important for me. And after 6 weeks, when they're like, okay, cool, we're gonna do it and everything, then I was like, okay, cool, now I'm gonna listen to the song again, and I listened back. And personally, I didn't like the verses so much. I think the beginning was dragging a little bit. And I wasn't sure. I thought like, okay, if I come up with a better idea, maybe I'm going to try it. Maybe just think about it. And in this case, you know, when you're thinking about something really intensely, sometimes ideas come to you. And in that case, I remember waking up in the morning at 5 a.m. and having this melody in my head, like this verse melody. And then when I went to the studio, I thought, like, okay, I'm just going to give it a try. And I liked it. So once again, I recorded myself. And this is how that sounds like.
I can feel your eyes on me.
All right, so yeah, then I had this and thought, okay, I cannot send it to Everglow in this shape. So once again, I brought Celia back in, recorded it, and sounded like this.
I can feel your eyes on me.
Yeah, I had to pitch her up still. And so on and so forth. You kind of know the rest. So this is how we got there. So as you can hear, it took a lot of turns. So if you watch this from the beginning, so it was like 20 different tracks that I made, and then had one idea that I liked, produced the entire thing, phoned a demo singer, sent it to Everglow, then realized I didn't really like the verses, writing the verses again, producing them again, and then bringing the demo singer back, and then sending it to Everglow again. And this version, the last one that you heard, this was done on June 23rd, right? So this one here, that was done on January 20th. Of course, I didn't only work on this song in the meantime, right? Like especially the 6 weeks, for example, in between where I didn't listen to the song at all. Of course, I worked on something else. So in between, there were like longer parts where I worked on something else. Yeah, but this is a little bit behind the scenes how I approach a song and what's happening and how messy it also can be. So let's have a look at the actual project. And we're gonna switch to Ableton Live. Ta-da! This is the thing. This is some extra stuff that I have here. So this is 155 tracks at the moment, but the vocals are already like very reduced here. So the vocals themselves are another 150 tracks. So overall, the song has like around 130 tracks. So I'm just gonna go through them from the top to bottom, show you a little bit what does what and so on and so forth. So we have the intro. So I'm going to focus on the instrumental part now because that's more the music production. And then show you a little bit how the vocal mix was done. I think that's the other part of the music production. Cool. So this is the intro. There we go. Oh my God. Let me do something real quick. You probably don't hear a lot what you should hear. Let me go up with the... with the sampler. Okay, now it should be working. So this is just some atmospheres here. This is a double bass. This is a... With a flanger phaser on it. So this is without the phaser, with the phaser. For those who are wondering, this is Ableton Live. that I'm using. Other great softwares that you can use are FL Studio, for example, Logic. They all work great, Cubase and so on and so forth. Whatever, if it feels right for you, it's great. The reason I like personally like Ableton Live, this might sound funny if you're a starter, but it's easier to use than, for example, Cubase. It's more simple. It's more reduced to what you need for music production. A lot of other digital audio workstations are done in a way that they're very flexible. Like, you can do like film scoring with them, and you can do also post-production, everything. They're like very versatile. Ableton Live is less versatile. It's just for music. So if you want to do like a surround mix, for example, it's not possible with Ableton Live. But if you want to do music, which is in stereo, then it's easier to use. So that's why I like it. Okay, so like double bass with a flanger, and this, honestly, I don't know where I have this from. Maybe from Omnisphere. I think this is also from Omnisphere, and I think this is also from Omnisphere. This is from Desert Winds and Atmosphere, and another Atmosphere from Omnisphere. And this is from my Splice sample pack. Go buy my Splice sample pack right now. No, I'm just kidding. So this is cello and viola and violin. I don't know why I used so many of them. And then also, once again, put a flanger on them. Cool. That's the intro. And then, of course, you have all girls singing. No, I think it's three of them singing at the same time. They're very matched, so I put a lot of like Melodyne and everything on them to match them as one. Who was it? I don't know, recall from the top of my head. I'd have to look in the project. All right, let's go to the verse. Just gonna start from the top. So it's a kick that I made. I made it with Kick, this VST plugin. I made this kick. Oh, this is really interesting, I think. I have a snare which has a lot of reverb on it. It's more like a wood block. I think. And the computer needs a break. There we go. So this has a lot of reverb on it, and this is completely dry. This is just a VirtuaRite mod step percussion snap. Doing it this way, what happens is this reverb here, since it's very soft, it does not mess with your... So if I would have a reverb on this one as well, it would be a lot of high frequencies in the reverb, and that would kind of mess up the entire frequency range. So it would be much harder to mix overall, because a lot of the vocal frequencies, a lot of the S and F and Sh and all those and the vocals, it would be covered up by the reverb from the snap, right? If you put a reverb on this one, you're gonna have Ch-ch-ch, and this would cover up the vocal. So what you want the reverb for is you want it to give space. So I decided to only put the reverb on this one here, right? Then we have just some snare breaks. So this is not so important. Hi-hat, just the 808 hi-hat. And another hi-hat. What is this one? Oh yeah, so it's just some hi-hat layering. Playing slightly different stuff. And what I think, let me see real quick. No, I don't have any grooves on this one. Yeah, because what I did later is that I randomized them a little bit, but not in this part here. Okay, so this is also not important. This is a 808 crash. This is a noise crash that I made myself. So I tried to make the crashes here very high frequency. So they don't, if you have a user crash, oh, there's one left here that I muted. Oh, this is also okay. Yeah, just make sure that they also doesn't get in the way of the vocals. Okay, so this is not important. I mean, this it's kind of not nothing wild here. This is a bass from Omnisphere. Let me see. Yeah, I think it's called Crackling Bass. It has those high frequencies, and I think it usually has even more. Just cut off the high frequencies here. And then sidechain compressed it to the kick. So I have the kick here. So whenever you see here, whenever the kick hits. Oh, let me play together with the kick. So it doesn't get in the way of the kick if I turn this off. Yeah, it takes away punch from the kick if you would turn this one here off. Oh, wait a second. I think, yeah. So now you can actually see it better. All right, once again. I realized it was hidden behind my the video of me. So once again, you see here, the kick is sidechain compressed, the bass is sidechain compressed to the kick. Whenever the kick hits, it pushes away the bass. If you turn this off, listen to the kick, how it changes the sound of the kick. The kick is so much thinner. Now you really feel the kick has a lot more punch. Okay, now this is a really important part of the entire song here. Let me switch this off and play to you. Feels like almost everything is there, but something's missing. So this is this part here. Some flutes. And where did I get these flutes from? I recorded them. That's actually me playing flute. Let me show you that I already prepared this here for you. So this is me. I took an actual flute, took this microphone here. Okay, so and then recorded a couple of tracks and then threw a couple of effects on them. I don't have them all right now. So one important thing is that it's a quarter delay. So it's the flute just plays dung 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 dung, and then the delay goes dung kang kung kang kung kang, fills in the gaps between, right? Yeah, and then there's a lot of let me see real quick. Maybe I can show this to you. No, I don't have it here at the moment. Sorry. There's some like wobble effect on it. I think that's a lot of filter as well, chorus and distortion as well, just to give this vibe. But the thing is, you kind of hear that it's acoustic, yeah, right? Because every note is different. You don't get this vibe from pure synthesizer. And that's what I was going for. So if I turn off the vocals real quick. And one thing also important to note is there are only two instruments that are making space right here. That's the flute and this here. So if I turn this up, off. See, it's completely dry. No, that's not true. This one also has a little bit of room on it, the lead. That's the one that I didn't show yet. So I think this is like an electric piano. This has a little bit of room on it, but not a lot of depth. So the depth only comes from this one and this one. Yeah, Yeah, I'm talking about this because I'm talking about this a lot when I do song reviews. I always tell people, you know what, when you mix, make a conscious decision about which song should be, which sound should be far away and which sound should be close. And if you want to create depth in your music, you don't have to put a reverb on everything, obviously. And you can be very selective about it. And once again, what I said here, what's really important is that there is no... Let me do this. Actually, let me do this real quick. Let me put some reverb on this one here. You can see I have a couple of reverbs. So let's do put a nice bright reverb on it. Alright, so we have, okay, cool. Now I have, so if I play this now and put in the vocals. See, all this reverb is doing, it's only clashing with the vocals. But you need some reverb, because if I wouldn't have this one... Right? This is what creates the depth, but it doesn't really get in the way of the vocal. Okay, so this is also really important for me, because I talk about this a lot when I do song reviews. Leave space for the vocals. It's so important. And also, what I was about to say is, when your mix doesn't sound good, it's often the production, right? So it's often the sounds that you select and how you combine them. So if you have the sound selector right, so this is like getting the sound right here. There's nothing so special about the mixing there. No, like tricks or anything. It's just the sounds are selected in a way that it works. And also, let me do something real quick. Let me put a analyzer on the instrumental. So now we can see the frequencies. I don't know what this is. Kind of, I don't. No idea. Okay. See this? Only the snap gets into this way. Oh, wait a second. You're not seeing the window. I'm sorry. Oh, you cannot see. Oh my God, you cannot see the other windows because of how I set up. Okay, let's do it here. Wait a second. Let me do it a different way. I'm sorry. See this? No. Okay. So now you can see it. Hopefully. Let me see if you can see it. Yeah, of course you can see it. Okay. Yeah, now you can see it. Okay, so if you look at this part here, if I take out the snap, you see this? There's like a complete lot of frequencies missing, right? And that's a decision I made in the production, not so much in the mixing, right? And this is where the vocal can cut through. So if you put in the vocal... Of course, the vocals, they go a lot lower in their frequency range as well, but where you understand the vocals, so where you understand what is actually said, that's in this mid to high mid frequency range. Okay, so the only thing that cuts into that frequency range is the snap, but it's very short, and that's why it doesn't interrupt the... Oh, it interrupts the vocal, but it still leaves enough space for the vocal because it just cuts through it really short. Okay, so much about the verse. It's just this lead here. This left, so it's electronic piano. This is how the verse is set up. The second verse is pretty similar. There's just some... just an arpeggio here coming. Oh yeah, and then important is they have some variation, of course. So when it we have those chords here. So it gets a little more busy in the second half of the verse. But it's still soft enough so the voice can cut through in this part. What else did I want to say? Oh yeah, one thing I did here. So this is all audio now. And one thing that I can show you is the clip, the transposition. I did this slight pitch on the bass. So let me do it more extreme. Right, so it's starting lower. But it's very, very subtle. And I'm doing the same with flute as well. Envelopes, clip, transposition. I can feel your eyes up. You can always hear the first one's a little lower. Right? Once again, making more extreme. So this is what the flutes are doing. So it's this one, I think maybe the lead as well. Let me see. No, not the lead. So it's the bass and the flute, I think. Yeah, and then also this one here as well. So why? What are you doing, Chris? Why are you detuning it? Well, to make it more interesting. Otherwise, it sounds very stable, right? It's very electronic. So when it starts, and it's not that little. It's a quarter note. No, it's an eighth of a note. But it's 25 cents. So 25 cents, it's... If I would detune the entire thing 25 cents, let me do this real quick. So. This is how it starts. Right? This would be correct. And this, it's a little flat on purpose, right? So the point is to make it less computer sounding. And yeah, like I said, I have it here as well. You can hear it, it's like, just coming, starting a little bit too low. I don't know if I have it here as well. Yeah, I think I have it. Yeah, it's one more synthesizer coming in here. Okay, and then... Oh, and then there's one thing that I can talk about. It's like writing melodies in this verse. I'm gonna start a little more philosophical on this one. So, how do emotions happen? And one important way to, like, what creates emotion is, like, stuff that happens minus your expectations. Right. So if you, let's say you get $10,000, would that make you happy or would that make you sad? Well, that kind of expected a little bit if what do you expect? Right. You would say, oh, that would be amazing. $10,000. Yeah. If you don't expect $10,000, that's amazing. Then it makes you happy. But if you won the lottery and you expected it to be like 10 millions and you think, oh, it's 10 millions and you're celebrating for a week and then you actually get the money. It's like, oh, no, for whatever reason, maybe it's only $10,000. Those $10,000 would be like, oh, my God, I'm so disappointed. So it's not the event alone that creates an emotion. It's also your expectation. What the hell does that have to do with this song? Well, important part of creating music is creating expectations and then playing with those expectations. So you can hear that in the melody here because, listen to it. I can feel your eyes on me. Right, once again. I can feel your eyes. Okay, listen what's happening now. Listen to the melody. So, what you can expect, probably not consciously, most likely not, because those things happen automatically, but after this happened two times, everybody's brain usually automatically says, okay, it's going again, but what happens is... So, it's a little... How's it called? Like it's tricking a little bit with your expectation. It's playing around with your expectations. So dum, pause, da, right? this is one of the ways how I try to keep the music interesting. So it's one thing that you can think about generally when you write melodies is think about, okay, what expectations am I setting up? And then how can I play with those expectations? And you set up expectations especially through repetition. So you repeat a thing a certain amount of time. And then after you repeat it a couple of times, you start changing it in a way. And depending on how you change it, but you can develop a feeling for that. Depending on how you change it, it's going to feel differently. It could be a chord progression. It could be a rhythm as well. It could be notes or everything at the same time. Okay, never let them know your next move. That's exactly what you want to do. Yeah, that's subconsciously what keeps your song interesting. Okay, so verse. I'm not gonna do the second verse separately, just real quick. So instead of this brass here, this is from Arturia, a synth. It's a preset actually. I have this choir. I think this from Omnisphere, maybe from Omnisphere as well, and then I also have the girls singing the same thing. Yeah, so everything together, then you have this. All right, so build up. Just a snare drum with a filter on it. And clap setting in. Then huge toms from, I think it's Damage. It's a contact library. Tons of effects. So here we have a crash. I think that's a splice thing. This one I programmed myself, so this is just a noise, white noise with a filter on it, then modulate the filter with an LFO. If you don't know what this means, no, don't worry about it, it's not so important. It's just effects. More effect. Another effect. Oh, this one is important, sort of, for me. So it doesn't only go up, it also goes down. Starting into this build-up. This one here gives a little depth. Okay, and then I replaced this bass. This one's yours. So this bass here. Very low, very deep. You wanna take something away. So the drop actually has some impact. So I replaced it with a organ. So this is the bass in the build-up, right? If you take it out, it's very thin. And what I established at this part, this is a electronic piano. Is this offbeat? So, in the beginning of. So the chords are playing 1, 2, 3, 4, right? And what changes here is. They play on the offbeat, so it's. Right? 1, so 1, 2, three, four, chuck, 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 chuck. So the chords switch from hitting the downbeat to hitting the offbeat. Which, while everything moves away, it gives you this feeling of, wait, it starts to move, right? Because when I go like one, dum, 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 it's very slow and keeps just marching. Why when you go like tuck and tuck and tuck, all of a sudden you have that it's moving forward. It's my theatrical performance to show you how it feels different. So that's what I mean here. So the keys, right? Tuck. And then here comes the saxophone. Okay, so then comes the drop. All right, kick drum. Very simple. This is one that I made myself. Very simple kick drum. This snare, it's combined. This is a wood block, I think, with an 808 snare and some side stick snare all together. Oh, and then I put a sausage fattener on it and some EQ. So together it sounds like this. So now you might say like, wait, why didn't you use this trick where you only have the reverb on the low frequencies and you keep the high frequencies clean like I did before? For those who just got into the stream, what I did in the verse is this, right? So the snap has no reverb on it, right? And I was explaining for a very long time why this is a great way to have a clean mix, and now all of a sudden I'm not doing it anymore. Why is that? Yeah, in the chorus, I want it to be more, like, not so clean, right? So I want, I'll get to that later, I wanted to have it like the drop, it has to be more energy, have more energy, and the things are a little bit more like competing against each other, right? The verse, everything's clean, and then the chorus comes and it gets a little bit more rough and a little bit more messy. That's why the snare has more, like, has also high frequency reverb now. What else do we have? So we have the kick, the snare. Then this is from Damage. What do you mean by Damage? Damage is a contact library where you have metals. Then snare fill. This is just an 808 snare fill. Then hi-hat. This is Addictive Drummer. It's a plugin which with acoustic hi-hats. I programmed it, but I made it a little bit not perfectly on beat. Let me warp this real quick. Maybe you can see it. Yeah, no, you cannot see it actually. Is it? Did I even do it? Yeah, you can see it here. So it's not quite perfectly on the beat, which makes it sound a little bit more organic. It's very subtle electronic hi-hat and an 808 hi-hat all together with this metal here. Those are the drums. Crash on it. And then I put some compression on the drums. One of the favorite words of music production YouTubers is glue. So this is for glue. Right? Some compression. If I turn this off, you can hear that the snare is a little bit too loud. So I made it a little bit too loud. and then compressed it back in. So this is how also the snare pushes away everything a little bit. Okay, let's get to the instruments. And as you can see, there are not that many instruments playing, interestingly. The most important part beside the saxophone in this part is this low vocal. This is from Omnisphere, and also really important, you can hear it starts lower, so I put some pitch bend. It almost starts like a half note too low. I can sing a D tonight. Yeah, the 808 does the same thing. So it starts a little lower. So it's an 808. And you can see this doesn't have a lot of low frequencies in it. So low frequencies are coming from the 808. And then we have a guitar. This is the funky guitarist, I think, from Native Instruments. So it's actually like a reggae guitar. Sunshine. No woman, no. Okay. And then we have the saxophone. Now, as you can see, you cannot see a lot of stuff that I did here. So, especially for you, or just for you, I got back the MIDI for this one to show you everything. And now I just realized that I cannot show you a lot because you can see when I open the windows, but I'll explain to you. So, this is the baritone saxophone from Contact. The Contact library sounds like this. All right, so I'm just gonna turn off all of these and go through them step by step by step. All right, so I put some distortion on it. And there are a lot of like harsh frequencies in it, so I put soothe on it to remove some of those harsh frequencies. Then Galfos is also, it's like balancing the frequencies automatically. So this is the original. Distorted. Soothe 2. Galfos, you already hear, oh, it's getting a lot closer. I don't know why this utility is in there. Oh, it just removes the very, very low frequencies, the DC from the distortion. Then some reverb. And then I compressed it after the reverb. So that way, I don't have, so it's, it has, how do I explain this? So it whenever the saxophone plays, whenever the saxophone does not play, the compressor is not working, therefore pulling the reverb in front. That's what I wanted to say. All right, so saxophone with reverb, saxophone with reverb, with compression. So this, what you see here, it's how much the compressor pushes down the saxophone, right? So when it plays, it's pushed down, and when it doesn't play, it's not pushed down, so it pulls the reverb to the front. Then more EQ. Just removing some of this mid-frequencies here. Just taking out some of this, mostly. Then adding a chorus to make it wide. And this here is compressor. This is compressing once again through the kick drum. At least it should be. It's not. Oh no, it's a different one. I'm going to explain to you in a second. And then LFO tool. So it's just a little bit. Every time it down becomes, it's still pushed a little bit further away. And then I have another EQ on it. Yeah. Yeah, this one takes away the mid frequencies even more. Yeah, so what you can hear is the most important parts. Let me turn off everything once again and put it back in. Generally, the most important thing is the distortion and the reverb. And everything else is EQing, just getting out those mid frequencies. Right, this is EQ, this is EQ, this is EQ, and this is EQ. So distortion, reverb, and EQ. Those are the most important things. Then compression. And also chorus to make it even wider. Yeah, and that's how you turn this. That's how you turn this into this. Okay, let me know if you have any questions about that. So this, it probably sounds a little bit different than the when I finalized it. That's pretty close to what I had here. All right, I don't see any questions. I saw that somebody was asking about this frequency in the guitar, so I think there was a very harsh frequency here. Yeah. That apparently bothered me in the mix. Very important that the saxophone shuts up when the girls sing in this case. And then we get to this very painful. Why is it painful? I'm going to explain to you. Second part. That was painful to produce. So first of all, we have another saxophone coming in, which is this one. I love it so much. So it's once again, it's the same actually. It's a baritone saxophone from Contact with Saturn on it. So it sounds like this. With Saturn on, a lot of distortion. Then with the doubler from Waves, which makes it stereo. A lot of EQing, as you can see here. More distortion. And a little bit of EQ. So it's mostly distortion and the doubler. And then what also happens is this here. So this is pizzicato strings. Let's turn up the vocals. So it just builds a little bit. And then also what happens is the hi-hats become more busy. You can see, originally I had to play through the entire thing. Like this. But that didn't even have so much impact. So I cut them up a little bit. So vocals are off, so you can hear the difference now between the first part of the drop and the second part. So we have this. And then the hi-hats getting busy. And then what's really important what happens here, you might think somehow the saxophone is not there that much anymore. Yeah, what happens is the vocals push away the saxophone. So let me make it really, really extreme. So especially in the beginning, you still have it, but as soon as the girls start to sing, right, it pushes away the saxophone. That's really important because otherwise you couldn't hear the vocals. I'm undoing everything. I don't know. So this first note, it's still full loudness, right? But as soon as it goes start, it's pushed back like 3 to 5 decibel. So what was painful mixing the vocals here? It was just because this part. It's just everything playing at once. That's kind of what I always tell people not to do. just play, it's the saxophone playing, it's a lot of beats playing, hi-hats, everything, pizzicato strings, and the lead, and the vocals at the same time, and the guitar as well. So this took me, honestly, took me like a week only mixing this part. The verse probably took me like 2 hours mixing, and this part took me, seriously, I got back to it day after day after day and was like, okay, start all over again and see how I can figure it out. Another thing that I want to show you is like, what I also did with the, so if you have everything here now, so this is all the instrumental stuff, so this is the drums plus the instruments, right? So drums, instruments, it all comes together here. And you may now, if you're a little bit to music production, you might think like, wait a second, what is this here? Decapitator. Yes, don't do this at home, kids, but yeah, it's a dangerous thing, but I really put some, it's pretty extreme, pretty extreme distortion on it. So what I did here, so I took all the drums plus the instruments and put some compression on it, so it's very fast, very fast attack, very fast release, high ratio. So what the, for if you're not into music production, what the compressor does is it takes the loudest signal and pushes it back, so your signal never gets too loud. So what it does here, it like compresses everything together. Let me take everything out here. I'm gonna take the vocals off real quick. And then once again, without. And with. Yeah, the difference, it's not huge. But it's definitely there, and it's more aggressive, more compressed, more angry a little bit. Right, if you take this off, it has more space. Everything has its space. You put all this stuff on, so it's a compressor, it's a decapitator. Oh my god, what did I click now? It's a compressor, decapitator, which is a distortion, a little bit of EQ, and a limiter. So if you put this on, it... Once again, without. Once again, with. And the computer stops. Great. Once again, with. Yeah. Yeah, it's more aggressive, it's more crunchy, if you will. So that was the goal here. This is more an advanced technique. I wouldn't recommend it when you start producing music, but if you wanna like push your music production a little bit, like if you're pretty advanced already and you're pretty happy with your sound and you're like, oh, I just want to have it a little bit more aggressive, this is something that you can do. Especially what's important here, I didn't do it on the vocals. So what this allows me to do is like compress all the instrumental into one thing, like give it sort of a frame and then sprinkle the vocals on top, sort of thing, right? So you limit the dynamic range of the instrumental, and you do not push the vocals. So if you would do the entire thing with the vocals as well, it would like mesh the vocals into the instrumental, so they wouldn't be on top so much anymore, right? But if you do it with the instrumental, so if you put like compression on the entire instrumental, maybe a little bit of distortion limiting, and do this all separately, and then mix the vocals completely separately, then you have it's easier to have the vocals more separated, which was really important here because there was so much going on and I wanted to have the vocals. Let's do that again. Oh my god. Okay. Yeah, as you can hear, I wanted the vocals to be on top. Getting back into the second verse, it's just some pling here. This is from just a bell and a resonant. This one has a lot of reverb on it. Close your eyes and hear my voice. This one we pretty much had already. Then we go to the second verse. Yeah, just some additional ad-libs on top, and then we have from Mia singing here. Okay, sorry that the audio is so distorted. I think the computer is a little bit getting to its limit here. Anyway, so you have it's important for me to have like some variation. So we had the ad libs in the second drop, and we have those you know, so it's echoed. I don't dare to press play, but let's try it again. You know what? Let me reset the. Oh, let's give it even more buffer. Maybe that helps. We will see. Is it still running? It's absolutely fine. Cool. Yeah, okay. So what I'm talking about is this here. You know, you want more. Right, this comes extra. Okay, then we have this one. Which is a completely new production, by the way. The break. So the kick is the same. Then we have this one you know already from the verse, but this one is new. And then some snare fills. Oh, those are the build-ups. Hide once again. This one here is from a contact library. I think it's called Rise and Hit. Crash. Nothing special here. Oh, this I built myself. Let me show if I can. Let's see if I can show it to you real quick. Effects, noise, phaser. I think that's the one. Okay. Just takes a second. I think it's a noise from Silent. Yeah. So I'm just gonna paint in a note here. Okay, so you just have a noise. I'm just gonna turn it on a little bit. Maybe turn it on a little bit more. So it's white noise. coming out of Silent. And you put in a phaser, this one here. But this still leaves a lot of the high frequencies through. So I put on EQ. And then put a chorus to make it wide. Okay, now I can turn it up a little more again. And then a lot of stuff gets controlled at the same time through macro. So you can see here. Now, I'm pointing with my finger on the screen. That doesn't make a lot of sense. I'm not used to streaming anymore. Sorry for all the mistakes I'm doing and everything. So I'm, yeah. So this frequency here, the feedback frequency, watch this thing here. So this is moving, right? And then also, because we're getting new frequencies, this one moves here as well. Right? So this is what I used here. This is just a saw, I think, with a lot of reverb on it. Yeah. So this is without the reverb. With the reverb. And then... I think this is from Omnisphere. I think this is sort of the bass here, right? Yeah. So from a production standpoint, what I'm doing here is sort of the same thing that I'm doing in the build-up, because this is also build-up, right? So you have a bass, but you don't want the bass to be like, you know, very strong. So once again, what we had in the build-up was this, right? Contrast this with the bass in the verse, right? A lot of low frequencies, build-up. Lot less frequencies, and then in the bridge, yeah. So this guitar works as a bass. Then what else do we have? Some bells, and then the saxophone getting filtered away, as you can see here. And what is this? Yeah. So this is the reggae guitar, but this gets actually filtered in. So this is, it's like, sort of feels like a crossfade. So one thing goes away, the other thing comes. Okay, yeah, if, let's hope that my computer won't wants to work. This one here, this is a little altar boy, like this effect here. So it's not pitched, right? The pitch stays the same, but the formants are pitched down and then they go up again. Yeah, and it goes further, so you it's like you, it goes down, then goes back up, and then goes even further, as you can hear. And then it picks up this "Catch Me If You Can." I think it's a whisper here. Catch me if you can. I think that's EU, if I can remember correctly. Yeah, and this is the bridge, the breakdown. Come and get me. Yeah, somebody was commenting, my computer is not having a great time. No, definitely not. Still. Kick drum, nothing special here. So, pretty huge clap. So this is from Stylus RMX. This is Virtual Ride Splice. And this is a snare, just to give it more impact probably. That's really important that, like, this is this clap, without this clap, this part. So this, the especially this one here. This is really important to make this part huge. If it, yeah, so once again with this clap. Catch me if you can. Come and get me. Yeah, and then it's the same 808 again. Yeah. Oh, and for those, I have a little something. For people who follow my stream for a very long time, something nice for you. So first of all, this is a saxophone with a lot of distortion on it. Another saxophone with a lot of distortion on it. Cashmere splice stabs. Another horn stab. And a trombone section all together. And then I think what happens. No, it's. Come and get me. No, I thought this would be muted, but it's actually not muted. Yeah, so how come do you come up with those sounds? I think I started with this one. And you just add stuff, you're like, oh, I want this to be like more aggressive. But then I also want it to be more specific. Oh, and I want it to be also more in the, like more connected with the saxophone. And what I also did here, I think. Yeah. No. Yeah, I think I pitched the 808 a little bit again, so it starts a little bit lower and then gets on its actual pitch. I think so. Now, this is for people, what I promised. Let's see in the chat if anybody recognizes this. What is this? Anybody recognizes the sound? Sun piano! Yay! Yeah, it's one of my favorites. I use it in a lot of different tracks. Starting, yeah, from Nexus. Starting 2012, I think the Foster the People remix was the first one. It's in Unity as well. It's usually pretty subtle. There are also a lot of tracks where I don't use it in, but exactly, I use it exactly like this. Let me see if I have Unity real quick. Archive, PC, released Unity, master. Oh, stop playing. No, I don't want to play through the entire thing now. Anyway. So, yeah, I wanted to show you a part where the sand piano is in Unity. I'm going to throw it in here real quick. Just to give my computer a little bit more challenges so it's not getting bored. So let's put this output so it's not running through the master. So, external out. Does it work? I wonder if you guys can hear it now. Let me see. No, you can't hear it. No, you can't hear, but give me a second. I'm just gonna let run through the master. That's why I show you where I use the sand piano. It's just a important emotional thing for me. Okay. Why is it not working? Oh yeah, because the master's turned on. So you hear that? The ta ta ta. Yeah, that's where I used it. In Unity, and also a lot of other tracks. Also, especially this thing. I have to turn on all the master stuff again. So then a lot of, let me turn on the, just a ton of hi-hats starting to play here. And snare fills. And some crashes. And this one here. It's just a wood block. It's just playing. Very important, this part here. Seriously. Otherwise, if you take this out, it feels very unconnected. It's like, whoa, what's going on? And then it's the soft voice. And this kind of keeps the low frequencies, but still makes obvious that this is a transition. Almost there. Kick drums the same pretty much. Okay. Snare fills right this time. More relaxed. Long crash apparently. No, I don't know. Yeah, so not that much going on here anymore, of course. Very soft. Same 808. This is Omnisphere, I think. This is a Glockenspiel. That's pretty much it. Yeah, so this part lives very much from the girls singing. There's a lot of them singing at the same time, a lot of core harmonies going on, and also some vocoder behind it, I think, if I remember correctly. And once again, it's all of the girls singing at the same time. Ooh. Okay, let's listen a little bit to the vocals. Personally, I don't find it so interesting from production standpoint. Recording was pretty standard. It's
I can feel your eyes on me.
Just some EQ, delay, reverb.
I can feel your eyes on me. You are near, chasing down my civil life.
And then just copying it. With a lot of reverb on it. And then we have this. Harmonies as well with a vocoder. This one here is then the all the girls sing at the same time.
Come and get me.
I think so. Maybe Sheeran is not in it, or, but I think.
Come and get me.
Very much driven by Mia.
Come and get me.
Just a, this is just all of them. There's not a lot of effects on it actually. It's just a little bit of distortion, EQ, and then delay and reverb. Pretty standard
come
as well.
And get me.
And this here.
You know you want more, so come try and catch me if you can.
Also a lot of them, I think it's all of them singing. I think three of them are singing the main voice, two are singing the lower voice. Once again, distortion, equalizer, and delay.
You know.
Why did I mix in it for so long? Yeah, the configuration of the EQ and the distortion, everything that took so long. I mean, I could go into all the detail now. The point is, as soon as you just exchange one singer, you have to do all the configuration differently, right? If I would just take out, let's say, Mia here, the entire mix would be different. So yeah, so that's the thing about like mixing vocals. It's very, I think it's very individual, and it's not so. It's not so crazy what I did there. It's pretty. I think the chorus here and the verse.
I'm a voice in your ear.
It's quite a bit of chorus on it. That's more the most important thing here. Yeah, and then same thing again. The echoes. So once again, this is more creative. So this is Little Altar Boy from Soundworks. What's the developer? Sound Toys, Little Altar Boy. You can change the formant. And then this once again. Once again, all the girls singing at once, unison, and then, as you can hear, a lot of distortion on it. Yeah. Yeah. Yes, and that is the production for Ghostlight. As you can see, quite a few things going on here. Yeah, if you have any questions, feel free to ask them right now. And I will do my best to answer them. Let's have a look here. I hope the stream has been going okay. But what's a process? Okay, let me. In the beginning, you showed us your voice sounded like a girl. How did you do that? It's just pitched up, so you can just take whatever it is. So now if I do it with the girls, they're gonna sound like Mickey Mouse, but I'm just gonna do it so you have the vocals.
Hear my voice in
and you just pitch them up. Oh, let me warp them.
Close your eyes and hear my voice in your ears.
Right?
You think that I'm far away.
So if you do this with my voice, it sounds more like a girl. I wish it would sound like a girl. That would be cool because then I could sing my own demos, but it doesn't. So it's something in between. Cool. How did you EQ the brass sax layers in the bridge? Let me see. Bridge. Lead. EQ. Yeah, you cannot see the window right now, but there's actually really not a lot going on. I can redo it. So it's just pulling out at 720 hertz and then adding low frequencies. So it's really, the sounds, I can play this and switch the EQ off. So I took out this frequency. So this is a little bit less. And this one here, the very low stuff is more. Oh, and I just realized I forgot the mastering. I did a little bit more here. Usually what I always tell people is mastering's not that important, and I totally stand by that. I did a little bit more here. So I did a little this one here, this one, the UAD MPEX. That's a tape simulation. So it's a little bit of distortion. So it's tape saturation. Just make it a little bit more grungy. Then EQ that you cannot see at the moment. But this is not so important because I just... So this... let me take out the EQ. Maybe play the drop so you hear the difference. It doesn't do a lot. So this is... So mastering for me, it's always... So you do the mix, right? And you listen to the final mix. And often overall you're thinking, oh, it has a little bit too much high frequencies, for example. Or in this case, it didn't have quite enough mid frequencies. Now, if you have the mix finished with 150 tracks or 300 tracks if you add the vocals, and in the end, like, oh, it's missing a little of mid frequencies, you could now go back to all the 300 tracks and add a little bit of mid frequencies. Or that's when mastering comes in, you just go to the master bus and you add a little of mid frequencies. So that's the point, right? So you everything's balanced in its on its own. Everything's balanced, but overall, it's not quite there, right? So this is with this EQ. This is without. Very subtle difference. What I added is this. So this is more extreme. So a little bit of this. And took out those frequencies here, the harshness and the low mid frequencies. So those I took out, and the mid frequencies, those ones here, I added. So it goes from here to here. Subtle difference. Then I had some multiband compression. This is just compressing the high frequencies and compressing the low frequencies a little bit, just so it doesn't get too harsh, and that it and that the limiter later doesn't have so much to do with the low frequencies. This one here is just removing the very very low frequencies. So here's some stuff at probably like 20 or like 10 hertz or something. It's not music anymore. It's just rumbling. And you wouldn't hear it anyway. It's just taking away energy from your mix. And what I mean by it's taking away energy, it's like you need the space. On technical, technically speaking, you need the as much of the range of the dynamic range as possible. And if you have this very low frequencies in it, it takes away the dynamic range. Now, this one here is a little bit more interesting. This is a saturator, and it's put a digital clipping. Once again, this is something you have to be really, really careful with. So it clips the snare. So look here. So it's just very, 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 very peaks. They get completely cut off. Which is a pretty dirty way of doing it. It creates digital distortion. But in this case, it works. But you gotta be careful with it. And then you just have your limiter. L2 to make it loud. This one I just put in to have a, that way could have a look at the frequencies. So this is the mastering chain. Yeah. Nothing too special here. Just trying to get the mix a little bit under control. Just adjusting the overall sound a little bit. Okay, once again, if you have any questions, feel free to post them. So I'm just gonna go through the from bottom. It's Q&A time anyway, yeah. Yeah, the if you want to do a sing-along, the instrumental will come out next week. Also next week, I will release the Korean version as well. We recorded the verses in Korean. Also going to release that as well. Oh yeah, sorry once again if the connection is not that good. My internet here is not so good. Could you please work on your stream's quality? Yeah, yeah, it's not so much I could work on it. I think it's the internet connection. But what I can do, I think they have this... oh, let me switch back to me so you can don't see the project anymore. What I can do... there is a different way of, like, a different sort of internet that I could buy here. Maybe that would make sense. Oh, yeah, so... how do you get to turn the sounds and vibes from your head to specific sounds and configurations? That's a lot of, it's simply practice. So one thing that I always recommend to people is just reverse engineer other people's work, not to release it, but just to learn. So you hear a song that you like and you try to recreate it. So you what you have to do then is you have to recreate the chords. So you're like, ah, those are the chords that he or she used. And those chords give me those vibes. Or maybe you realize, oh, the chords don't do anything but the melody, or maybe it's the sound. So just by recreating stuff, that's one important thing. And then I'm not going to go back to that, but when you watch the beginning of the stream, oh, and by the way, I'm going to upload this. This is going to be VOD, so video on demand on Twitch. And I'm also going to upload it to my vlog channel on YouTube so you can watch it there as well. So in the beginning, I showed you all the different stuff that I made. Like I did a lot of layouts in the beginning, and you learn so much because you just try out different stuff again and again and again. Right? You just say, okay, I wonder what if I like shift chords chromatically up and down, right? You do it and it sounds like crap, and you're like, okay, cool. And the next day you do something different. You have like you put a flute in a distortion and all of a sudden sounds amazing. You're like, oh wow, I created a new lead and it feels like this, and then you learn something. So it's just like randomly trying out stuff. It's a little bit like a scientist to me, right? A scientist as well, you just do run experiments again and again, but those are emotional experiments, and in the end the question is how you feel, how it makes you feel. So this is it's a very personal thing. Yeah, instrumental version is coming next week together with the Korean version. Also going to release the stems as well. Okay, what else do we have? When you're working on a song, do you ever get tired of hearing parts of it or repeat it over and over again? That's a very good question. That's why I'm very picky with the ideas that I decide to do, right? So I played all those different things to you in the beginning, all the different ideas, maybe 20 or so different ideas. And I just chose this one idea, and all the other 20 ideas, I kind of put them in the trash. And the reason is I really have to love the idea to work on it. Otherwise, I'm not doing it. Yeah, because it made... so the overall time that I spent on this song, I think is probably like 700 hours, I would say, roughly. So you really have to like the song. Otherwise, yeah, just like I said, you're going to get bored from it. Did I answer your question? Let me see what your question was. Oh, yeah. Do you produce ideas with the mindset that these are just going to be ideas and might develop into nothing? Yeah, sort of. It changes a little bit. It goes back and forth. Sometimes I want to create a hit song. And I'm very like narrow, so not so creative. I'm trying to force it. And then I'm like, oh, that sounds like everybody else. So then I'm like, oh, I'm just going to go really weird and really crazy. And then I make a lot of stuff that sounds horrible. because I just do weird stuff, and then I know I should focus more on making hit songs. So it goes back and forth a little bit. Or I want to make this work, or perhaps a little bit of both. Yeah, a little bit of both, and it's a pendulum swinging back and forth. Have you tried any freeware apps for composing, mixing, and any you would recommend? I haven't tried any of them. As far as I know, Reaper is freeware. I think it's pretty good. A lot of people use it. So if you want to try something for free, I would recommend this. Will you live streams of you doing ideas? Maybe, but I don't like it so much, I must say. A lot of the time, nothing's coming out of it. Also, the other thing is, I tried 2 years ago, I think. I did a lot of streams. That's when I got the, partner, Twitch partner. But I usually, when I do it, first of all, I do it very early usually. So I hit the studio at 6 or 7 in the morning, and that's how I look like. And then I do workout, and then I go to shower. So I'm in the studio before I even hit the shower. So this is how I look like. I don't kind of don't want to be on camera like that. This might sound a little like, I don't know, sound like a little superficial, but I mean, imagine yourself just standing up in the morning, doing nothing, and then putting a camera in your face and streaming it to the world. So I hope you understand that. So this is one aspect of it. And the other aspect is I go really deep when I produce music. I really get really into the zone. So I forget everything else. And when I have like, oh, there's the camera running and people are watching me. It's a little bit distracting. It's also kind of giving me energy, but it's also distracting me a little bit. So maybe I'm going to do it a little bit when it's not in the early morning. But we will see. I don't have specific plans for it at the moment, at least. If you already answered this, but why did you take so long to release something? Yeah, one of the main reasons was that I moved to Cyprus, and it took a lot of energy to do the actual move, but it took 10 times, 20 times more energy with the bureaucracy in Germany when you want to move out of it and you have like a song catalog. They're going to tax you to death. Literally, I would be like, you pretty much bankrupt if you just leave Germany and you have a lot of successful catalog. Yeah, kind of annoying. Anyway, don't want to whine around here. So doing all that stuff, it took just about half a year. And I had to release the album. And then I got all busy. And then I started in the beginning of this year, like I said. But it just took a lot of time to finish the song. But the good thing is now I have a lot of songs almost finished, or others are finished as well. So there will be a steady flow of releases now, finally. My Twitch link tree is outdated, I think. Yeah, thank you so much for letting me know. Okay. When I was composing some music, I reheard it so often that it became even more difficult to make some changes to it. So I won't recommend. Yeah, what I try is just listen to a specific part. So when I work on the sound, I just listen to the sound. I just try to focus on the sound, for example. What you shouldn't do too much is like listen to the overall thing again and again and again. Just, you know, like kind of enjoying your song. If you do that too much, you're not enjoying it anymore. could you play, please, some of your unreleased tracks with drop-like sound in your vocals? No, I'm very, very sorry. I'm just going to answer some questions. What's your favorite compressor? How to deal with the distortion, right? Oh, good question. Compressor is hard to tell. One that I really liked is the glue compressor in Ableton Live. What I really recently discovered is the Mic E from SoftTube. That's really, really good. So if you're not in Ableton, I would probably recommend trying out that one. Distortion. I like kind of like the, what's it called? A Saturn 2 from FabFilter. Yeah, and just, you just gotta be careful with it. Just push it to the point where you just hear it just a little bit. But also Decapitator, of course. Any advice for a person who wants to be a producer? Yes, just make sure you do it for the right reason. And that reason should be that you enjoy producing music. right? If you really think, like, if you watch the stream and you're like, oh, this is super interesting, I would love to do something like that. Not because you think like, oh, the people will like love me or you're going to be famous or make a lot of money, but because you find this interesting, that's great. That's great. If you think like, oh, I'm going to have like 6 million subscribers and everybody, like all my friends are going to be like, oh my God, he's so cool. That's not a good thing because it's probably not going to happen that quick. For me, it took like 10 years before it really took off. And it's going to be very frustrating, right? You put a lot of effort and time to it and then it's not working for 10 years. And you're like, oh, I'm wasting my time. So for me, I'm never wasting time when I produce music. I just enjoy it. So this is the most important advice. And other than that, if you want to get started, just get yourself a DAW, like a digital audio workstation, like Ableton Live or Reaper or something like that. And watch some tutorials and maybe even subscribe to a tutorial website. There are a couple of them. And see like a course like making my first song in Ableton Live. And then just, yeah, follow the instructions and see what you can get out of it. So just so you have a place to start. Can you place the worst beat or song you've made, something comically bad, if it exists? Oh, it certainly exists. I just wonder if I can find it that quick. Let me see. I have some funny ones. Not the bad ones, but I have some funny ones. A little bit like Super Mario or Nintendo-ish. Why is my finder not there? Why is my finder? Oh, because it's here. Okay. Let me see. Give me a second. No. 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 So this is, I have no rules for when I try new stuff. So sometimes I can do, often I have like an idea or a goal that I want to achieve. Like, okay, I want to make something that's really danceable and really, you know, I don't know, next level. And sometimes I get into the studio in the morning, I'm like, oh, I really have no inspiration today. And when I don't have inspiration, I still work, but I start making something really crazy. Let me see if I have anything else. Oh yeah, this is a little bit similar. I think, yeah, this is sort of the same thing. I don't know, I was just playing around with it, but more acoustic. Like Cantaloupe Island feeling. It's a little bit Nintendo-ish or Cantaloupe Island. So I just, yeah, as you can hear, I'm just playing around with stuff. I think it's very, 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 very important when you produce music that you keep it fun, right? And this is my way of keeping it fun, just making like crazy stuff. So when I feel like, okay, I just want to make Nintendo music, I make Nintendo music. Bot is banning me because my questions are too long. Sorry for that. All right. Any other questions? I think I got deleted, so sad. It's funky, yeah. Sounds like outro music, yeah. That's what I do, outro music. All right. Yeah, for those of you who don't know, if you watched, if you saw the outro trend on TikTok, that's my song, by the way. Do you have a favorite producer? Max Martin, overall. Just because he's the most successful, and he's like ridiculously successful. If you don't know who he is, look him up. It's like made like half the top hits in the last 20 years. Yeah. On how many songs have you worked this week? I think 3 different ones. Yeah. I'm gonna withstand the temptation to play you the new tracks right now. Sorry for that, but yeah. All right. I think it's a wrap. I hope. Yeah, Max Martin is the bad. Red one's also great. Yeah. I hope you learned something today. I hope you found it interesting or at least entertaining. Thank you so much, everybody, for joining me today. And sorry for the bad stream quality. I'm gonna try and fix it. Gonna try and find a way to make it better. It's just the internet here. Sorry for that. Anyway, I'm gonna upload it on. It's gonna be VOD. I'm also gonna upload it as well on my channels. And since it's recorded, I hope the recording is still working. Yeah. It should be without any of the issues that we had here. So long. Thank you so much for watching. And I don't know how to turn the stream off. No, I think I found it. And yeah, thanks so much for watching. And I'll be back when I have a new song. That's when I'm going to do the same thing again. Bye-bye. Have a good day, night, or whatever it is for you. See you.